controversies about beta blockers as a subject of interest and of greater importance when it comes to managing hypertension in different categories of patients, whether they are young or older, and whether they have specific associations that I'm going to shed the light upon. This is why my title is Controversies. And the initial assessment that I will start with is, what are the pharmacokinetics and what are the different specifics about beta blockers? As you know, beta blockers decreases heart rate, prolong SA node refractoriness, slow down conduction rate over the AV node, decrease myocardial contractility, and affects the beta 1 and beta 2 receptors selectively with different levels. I will start with talking about what is sympathetic overdrive. It's a form of chronic activation of the sympathetic nervous system. The key clinical feature is elevated heart rate, which is a very common finding that we see in our patients, those who are coming for evaluation or assessment of their hypertension. Elevated heart rate is a major risk factor for cardiovascular disease and is associated with increased all-cause and cardiovascular mortality. In order to prevent the adverse effects of sympathetic overdrive, beta blockers have the ability to reduce that risk, including cardiovascular events and death. The cardioprotective effects are mostly mediated via the beta blocker receptor blockade. The key risk factors for sympathetic overdrive include type 2 diabetes, obesity, smoking, and stress. Highly selective beta 1 blockers like bisoprolol inhibit sympathetic activity in the heart and kidneys, meanwhile preserving the beta 2 mediated vasodilators. Why? Because of its highly selective beta 1 effect, thereby reducing adverse side effects. Guidelines recommended beta 1 and selective beta blockers for sympathetic derived hypertensive patients or symptomatic patients with higher heart rate. So who are the patients with hypertension and sympathetic overdrive who would benefit from beta blockers? For example, we have here Faisal, who is young and stressed, Mona with diabetes and hypertension, Salem, smoker, and Hisham, obese. All of these groups of patients who are very common, young and older, have sympathetic overdrive manifestations. In diabetics, the diabetes per se causes insulin level elevations, hyperinsulinemia that drives norepinephrine high and causes sympathetic overdrive. Stress activates the sympathetic nervous system by stimulating both alpha and beta adrenergic receptors. Obesity, which is linked to sympathetic overdrive and nerve activities, particularly when accompanied with hypertension. Smoking stimulates the sympathetic nervous system and actually significantly increases both blood pressure and heart rate. By that setup, resting heart rate in these groups of patients remain high, and with that, sympathetic overdrive can be diagnosed. Now, let's go more specifically into the obesity issue and relationship to sympathetic nervous system. You'll see, in particular, centrally obese patients have central adipocyte accumulations in the visceral area, with increased production of adipokines that are associated with increased inflammatory markers like TNF-alpha, interleukin-6. Endothelial inflammatory response will result in worsening endothelial dysfunction, as insulin resistance, production of insulin, and hyperinsulinemia. At the same time, increased production of leptin, who increases norepinephrine release and augments the process of sympathetic nervous system activation. In particular, centrally obese patients have a much higher likelihood to have what we call muscle sympathetic nerve activity augmentation compared to less centrally obese and also compared to lean patients. In type 2 diabetes, insulin resistance, hyperinsulinemia, there's a lot of norepinephrine release that contributes to ventricular arrhythmia, plasma renin activity, increased angiotensin II cascade, beta adrenergic stimulation, inducing cardiac and coronary artery atheroma and accumulation, blood pressure and non-dipping at night, and intraglomerular pressure that contributes to nephropathy. In UKPDS data, in addition to the, as you know, the late accumulating evidence of cardiovascular outcome reduction induced by or attributed to metformin, there is another observation over the periods of follow-up above 10 years of the what you call 23% reduction in death from patients who are receiving beta blocker, even when compared to patients receiving ACE inhibitor. Why? Because bisoprolol in particular has a 20-fold greater selectivity of beta 1 than beta 2 receptor agonist effect compared to betoxolol, metoprolol, atenolol, and others. Now, let's look at the pharmacokinetics. You will see that bisoprolol is more likely to be eliminated with a longer half-life, absorbed much higher than others, although others could be more or less the same. First pass effect, the lowest compared to other beta blockers. Bioavailability, the highest compared to other beta blockers. And protein binding, quite low, comparable to atenolol and metoprolol. And no active metabolites with clear balance through the system. Now, when compared to other beta blockers, bisoprolol and nebivolol, for example, you will see similar diastolic and systolic lowering of blood pressure over a period of 12 weeks as it is in this study. And again, when comparing to nebivolol, you will see, however, the heart rate effect is much stronger using bisoprolol compared to nebivolol by about 2.5 times. And there is also an additional 5-time more cardioselective effect of bisoprolol compared to nebivolol. So in general, the pharmacokinetics of these two drugs shows that both drugs are suitable for once daily dosing. Both drugs are almost completely absorbed. The bioavailability of nebivolol, however, is substantially reduced. Drug-drug interaction is much less likely to be with bisoprolol. Large interindividual variations of plasma concentrations between poor and fast metabolites, which is more likely to occur with nebivolol. Some people benefit more, some people benefit less. There's more consistency when it compared when we use bisoprolol compared to nebivolol. It can be used in patients with mild to moderate renal or hepatic insufficiency. And with that, however, nebivolol has to be adjusted in case of hepatic insufficiency. Bisoprolol has a greater beta-1 selectivity. And just to mention that intrinsic sympathomimetic activity has lesser outcome benefit compared to those who do not have it. Now, if compared to metoprolol, especially over a 24-hour coverage, you will see that the heart rate response over the last 4-hour interval of the 24-hour effect of the bisoprolol has a much more profound effect on heart rate reduction and also on dynamic effects of diastolic blood pressure in particular over a period of 24 hours. Again, when comparing bisoprolol to atenolol over in terms of the day and night, 24 hours, you will see there is a 33% reduction, greater reduction in whole day average diastolic blood pressure reduction with bisoprolol compared to atenolol. Now, the international guidelines have dictated lately that beta blockers remain a mainstay of hypertension treatment. However, early on, and let's start with the JNC in 2014 and earlier with the American Heart and the American College and the Heart Foundations, they did not really get together to give us a clear-cut view as to where is the job or where is the role of beta blockers. But later, in 2018, beta blockers were recommended as first-line therapy. And there are reasons why this happened. Let's first look at the latest data from the European Society of Hypertension and European Society of Cardiology in 2018, where you will see that heart rate has been recommended to be monitored alongside with blood pressure. This is a really important breakthrough. Secondly, that beta blockers are suitable for initiation of and maintenance of antihypertensive treatment alongside with diuretics, calcium antagonists, ACE inhibitors, ARBs, etc. In NICE, beta blockers were recommended to be considered for initial therapy of hypertension in younger people. So in NICE, a specific association with the age has been made. And in CHEP, a beta blocker in patients younger than 60 was considered as grade 2 B effect, a grade B class 1 effect in terms of age. Now, let's look more into the European Society of Hypertension and their recommendation. You will see that the improvement of healthy lifestyle was highly recommended. Lifestyle modification should include physical activity, smoking cessation, avoidance of excessive alcohol consumption or heavy coffee, dietary intervention, and aiming at weight control that would have helped to maintain a better blood pressure control. In patients who are symptomatic with treated with a cardiac slowing drug, a consideration should be given to selective beta 1 blockers, a beta blocker considered in younger people, especially in those with evidence of increased sympathetic overdrive, in combination with a diuretic or any other from the other major classes, is an alternative when there is a specific indication for beta blockers, in particular, as you know, angina, post-myocardial infarction, heart failure, and necessity for heart rate control. Again, the strategy for hypertension was emphasized in the guidelines clearly. It's a class one indication to consider beta blockers among other antihypertensives, including the ones I mentioned earlier, that has demonstrated effective blood pressure reductions with cardiovascular outcome event reductions in randomized controlled trials. Other combinations with other what you call classes of medicines were recommended to be used, and attention in particular when it comes to angina and post-myocardial infarction and heart rate to make the attention to slowing of the heart rate and its control. All of these were considered class 1A recommendation. Let's go to the Canadian guidelines and their management of hypertension. They recommended that beta blockers should be given in younger than 60 years of age. Initial therapy should be with either mono or single pill combination. Recommended monotherapy choices are thiazide-like diuretics, longer-acting diuretics, beta blockers in the younger, ACE inhibitors, ARBs, and calcium channel blockers. In the UK, the management of hypertension recommended also beta blockers that is considered to be recommended in the younger people, particularly those who are rather intolerant to ACE inhibitor, angiotensin receptor blockers, women of childbearing age, and people with evidence of increased sympathetic overdrive. The American Heart Association and the American College of Cardiology also considered beta blockers as agents to patients treated with hypertension, ischemic heart disease, or heart failure. Cardioselectivities, at that beta blockers with cardioselective effect initially were not considered as a first-line treatment unless the patient has ischemic heart disease and or heart failure. For that, bisoprolol and metoprolol were considered. Metoprolol succinate in particular. As you know, metoprolol succinate has a longer 24-hour effect compared to metoprolol tartrate. And these are, both of them are preferred for heart rate control and blood pressure management in patients with reduced ejection fraction heart failure. And they are also the preferred treatments when there is underlying bronchospastic airway disease. Now, the Heart Foundation also recommended beta blocker use in the patient with a previous myocardial infarction. Patients with a history of MI, ACE inhibitors, and beta blockers are recommended. Beta blockers or calcium channel blockers are also recommended in those with symptoms. So let's go back to the earlier guidelines and where is the controversy. Now, the international guidelines at the earlier than 2018 did not really recommend beta blocker as a first-line therapy for hypertension and restricted their use to special groups. Now, in fact, it was not mentioned entirely who are this group, but if you look at the studies based upon which the American Heart Association, the college, and also JNC8, you will see that most of the studies in the middle lane, you will see them, they are in people who are above 60 years of age. None of these studies were including patients younger than 64. This tells you that the recommendation is based on the elderly who are less likely to be affected with sympathetic overdrive. In summary, American Heart and the American College in 2017 did not include in their recommendation patients younger than 60, and thus their non-approval was based on research done with a heterogeneous group of patients, however, all of them exceeded the age of 60. GNC in particular in 2014 did not as well recommend first-line beta blockade as a treatment. In light of what? Life study and even ASCOT study. And with that recommendation, several previous JNC recommendations were made up until JNC8. And so many of the drugs were recommended. And if you notice, diuretics and beta blockers were added as of 1984. And beyond that, several other changes only to be ignored later in 2014. But in fact, the JNC algorithm for treatment of hypertension basically, although looked at age as a contributor, recommended the actual systolic diastolic blood pressure levels to be different between those who are older compared to those who are younger than 60, and accepted 150 over 90 in the over 60 and 140 over 90 as a target in those who are younger, but did not assign particular role for beta blockers. They did assign, however, based on gender, based on ethnicity, non-blacks versus blacks, the different categories of classes of medicines that you know about, and at the end they said maximize treatment, then second line treatments, then additional medications as needed in order to achieve the goals. So there is a confusion, no doubt about that. Now, what is it? Is it the class? What is the problem? What is the literature telling me? Let's go back to Ascot in the late 1990s. This is a double blind, almost 20,000 population patients with hypertension, more than three risk factors, compared amlodipine with atenolol. Amlodipine up to 10 milligram, whether with or without perindopril, and atenolol up to 100 milligram, with or without diuretic, and depending on the need for potassium coverage. And those patients were looked at in terms of myocardial infarction, silent or otherwise fatal, all-cause mortality, stroke as a secondary outcome, and others like non-fatal MI, silence excluded, all coronary events, cardiovascular procedures, mortality, fatal or non-fatal heart failure. Look at the results. Atenolol fared badly compared to amlodipine-based therapy in all subgroups, whether they're non-fatal MI, the other cardiovascular events, all-cause mortality, fatal, non-fatal cardiovascular events, tertiary endpoints, etc. All of these has been shown clearly in this trial. So let's go to life. It's a comparison between losartan and atenolol again in the treatment and of patients with hypertension in the and their effect on reduction of cardiovascular morbidity, mortality, and in the presence of left ventricular heart hypertrophy as an endpoint or contributing to end organ damage caused by hypertension. Now, included were 55 up to 80 years. Most of the patients were over 60. Elevated blood pressures up to 200. Systolic and diastolic 95 and above. Left ventricular hypertrophy both by Cornell and Sokolov criteria. And they looked at the comparative effect on composite of cardiovascular death, MI, and stroke, and showed that atenolol had higher event rate, and that higher event rate was significantly more than that when in patients receiving losartan. The success rate in smokers when we use beta blockers is also to be attended to, because hypertension in smokers, in comparison to atenolol, is showing that, again, there is a difference between atenolol and bisoprolol in particular, where you will see that smoking has higher diastolic blood pressure effect and a reduction effect when using bisoprolol compared to atenolol. So at bisoprolol, up to 20 milligram managed to have a significant reduction in diastolic blood pressure and in achieving less than 95 millimeters mercury than atenolol. Then here we come, let's say, what is happening. After Ascot and Life, the controversy surrounded the use of beta blockers. Now, against recommendations for the beta blockers, JNC8, panel limited the evidence based on the randomized controlled trials that I mentioned and meta-analysis, however, with systematic reviews or with meta-analysis or including all groups of patients was not included. The panel did not consider age regarding the pathophysiology of hypertension and did not consider smoking as an element of interaction with the beta blockers. When considering these studies with the beta blockers, the smoking interaction, as I mentioned earlier, particularly when it comes to using non-selective or moderately beta-1 selective beta blockers because of their modest effect, especially those related to non-smokers, the situation was not avoided, and thus we could have made a better conclusion if a highly beta-1 selective beta blocker such as bisoprolol would have been used in these studies, but they were not. Based on this recommendation, atenolol studies were used. Most beta blockers were reviewed like ESCOT and UKPDS, atenolol is not the best suitable beta blocker. It is only moderately beta 1 selective, considerably blocking beta 2 receptor in the range that is used, and it inadequately lowers central aortic pressure. Atenolol, it was given in these studies as once daily. As you know, atenolol is a short-acting drug and is not suitable for use as single dose daily. Life, where the consideration added to JNC panel included as well ages 55 to 80, mean 67, patient with hypertension and LVH, probably were not suitably fit for first-line treatment with beta blockers because of the age. Differences in pathophysiology of hypertension in middle age and elderly patients were not considered. So in summary, the use of beta blockers in the studies quoted for the recommendation before 2017 was based on meta-analysis in the young and elderly without separation. Beta blockers performed best in young and middle-aged, but less well in the elderly. And CHEP in 2014 recommended beta blockers and actually realized that it is a better drug, especially in those who are younger than 60, for initial therapy, as well as with drugs associated with it, like thiazides, ACE, calcium channel blockers, et cetera. So when are beta blockers indicated as per NICE guidelines? The NICE guidelines said that consider beta blocker to be used if younger with increased sympathetic activity, compelling indications such as ischemia, arrhythmia, MI or heart failure, blood pressure of a patient to be well controlled in when a regimen includes a beta blocker. And in that situation, there is no need to replace a drug by another. That is, if you want to add an ACE, it can be added on top of beta blocker or a calcium channel blocker on top of beta blocker. And usually beta blockers will fare even better if patients cannot tolerate other drugs like ACE inhibitors. So with the higher selectivity of beta 1 blocker like bisoprolol compared to metoprolol, atenolol, betoxolol, that highly selective beta 1 blocker inhibiting sympathetic activity in the heart and the kidneys without affecting the beta 2 mediated vasodilation can help reduce adverse effects mediated by beta blocker of beta 2 receptors in the lungs and peripheral tissues. Non-selective beta blockers block both beta 1 and beta 2. Relatively selective beta 1 are more cardioselective. Vasodilator beta blockers promote endothelial vasodilation and have a better metabolic profile. The cardioprotective effect of beta blockers are mediated through the beta 1 receptor blockade. Highly selective beta 1 blockers, bisoprolol, may therefore be preferable to less selective agents in managing those with sympathetic overdrive, hypertension, and cardiovascular disease. Let's go to the European Society of Hypertension and Cardiology 2013 and 14 guidelines, and you will see that diuretic ACE inhibitors, calcium antagonists, ARBs, and beta blockers can be considered suitable for initiation of antihypertensive treatment and their maintenance. The task force in both European Society of Hypertension and European Society of Cardiology indicated the main benefits of antihypertensive treatments are largely due to lowering of the blood pressure and is independent of the drug employed, that meta-analysis occasionally appear claiming superiority of one class over another, but this depends on the selection bias of trials. The largest meta-analyses available do not show clinically relevant differences between the drugs. And just to mention that in the guideline, in their guidelines, beta blockers were included as class 1A indicated in the management. This is the summary of the drug treatment as recommended, age under 55, age above 55, ACE inhibitors, calcium channel blockers on the other side, combination thereof of both, addition of a diuretic as a step three, and an additional step when resistant hypertension, both ACE, calcium channel blocker, diuretic, and further addition of alpha or beta blockers should be considered in order to achieve expert reduction in blood pressure. In summary, systolic, diastolic hypertension without compelling indication, that is no ischemic heart disease, no MI, no heart failure, a combination of first-line drugs may be considered if the blood pressure is more than 20 millimeter systolic or 10 millimeter systolic higher than target. Thiazide diuretics, ACE, ARBs, calcium channel blockers, and beta blockers to be used in dual combinations or triple or even quadruple therapies if necessary, as long as you achieve less non-adherence, secondary hypertension, interfering with drugs or lifestyle, or white coat effect. Now, single pill combination as a first line of treatment in systolic and diastolic has been recommended in the newer guidelines in 2017. And this included thiazide like ACE, ARBs, long-acting calcium channel blockers, and the combination of these medications together, all recommended as an approach towards improving control and compliance. The combined ACC, AHA, et cetera, all the societies have looked at the guidelines in prevention, evaluation, and management of hypertension, put it as class one indication to those with coronary vascular disease, 10-year atherosclerotic cardiovascular risk of more than 10, and a blood pressure target of less 130 than 80, not 140 than over 90, 130 over 80. And for adults, confirmed hypertension, but without compelling reasons, that is, without markers of higher cardiovascular risk, a target also of 130 over 80 should be achieved. And this is an example of what should be achieved, whether they are younger or older, with or without diabetes, with or without chronic kidney disease. 130 over 80 is the target and not 140 over 90. Now, let's look at the differences between the guidelines. Prevalence of hypertension in the JNC7 was 32% compared to 2017, ACC and AHA 45.6%. Number with hypertension in millions, 72 million at the time of JNC7, and in 2017, 103. So within 3 years, almost 1.5 time higher the prevalence of the disease in the United States. Now, recommendations of different guidelines were basically thiazides as a grade A, ARB or ACE as first line, all of these, calcium channel blockers, and basoprolol as grade B. Now, beta blockers are first line therapy as well in CAD and HFrEF, reduced ejection fraction heart failure. Now let's look at heart failure. Adults with reduced ejection fraction heart failure should be prescribed guidelines directed management based to lower blood pressure to 130 over 80. Calcium channel blockers in non-dihydropyridines are not recommended, however, to treat hypertension if there is reduced ejection fraction. Now, in adults with a preserved ejection fraction, and volume overload diuretics should be used. And if they are, after managing their volume overload, are prescribed ACE, ARBs, and beta blockers in order to titrate and attain systolic blood pressure target of less than or equal to 130 systolic. Upregulation of beta receptors are contributing to improvement in heart failure, slowing heart rate, increasing coronary flow, decreasing myocardial demand, suppression of ventricular arrhythmia, and RAS augmentation inhibition when added to ACE. Now, this is the guidelines towards the treatment of algorithm for HFrEF, reduced ejection fraction. I will not bore you, but just look at the color-coded green. You will see that therapy with ACE and beta blockers are class 1 indication. Addition of mineralocorticoid, if not sufficient, use exchange ACE with ARB or ARB with ARNI, like Entresto, sinus rhythm to evaluate for the need for CRT or for the need of additional gabapentin for augmentation of heart rate response, especially when they continue to have higher heart rates. And at the end, in a final stage, when necessary, the use of digoxin, hydralazine isosorbide, and LVAD, or other conditions like heart transplantation, and in order to achieve goals in those who cannot be attained with. Now, modifying therapies in HFrEF, ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, bisoprolol, carvedilol, et cetera, ARBs, MRAs, brilaprolol, spironolactone, and ARNI, all of these are highly recommended as per the American guidelines in 2016. Now, let's look at the ischemic heart disease. Again, guidelines indicated the use of BP target 130 over 80. Guidelines directed a treatment using ACE and ARBs for compelling indications, previous MI and stage and stable angina as first-line therapies should include dihydropyridine, thiazides, mineralocorticoids as needed. Now, with hypertension and CAD and ischemic heart disease, dihydropyridine, thiazides, mineralocorticoids are also to be included in management of angina. Beta blocker therapy as per AHA, ACCF in 2011 have also included the starting and the continuing of beta blockers for about for 3 years or more for patients with left ventricular function normal and have had previous myocardial infarction. And it is reasonable to continue beyond the 3 years in all patients with normal left ventricular function who have had myocardial infarction or ACS. So you really don't have to have LV dysfunction to use beta blockers. In stable coronary disease, heart rate reduction, contractility reduction, blood pressure decrease, adrenergic stimuli inhibition, cardiac work reduction, oxygen consumption reduction, and anti-anginal effect. All of this was also specified in SCAI recommendations that talked about angina relief and event prevention, cardiovascular outcome prevention, and beta blockers are among the first line treatments to be used along with calcium channel blockers and also non-dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers. May add and switch first line in some cases like evabrabine, long-acting evabradine. Unfortunately, we don't have it in Saudi. Long-acting nitrates, nicorandil, which is another what we call potassium channel drug, renolazine and trimetazidine. All of these last three are not available. Consider angio and PCI, of course, those who are in need. Of course, aspirin, statin, ACE inhibitors, and ARBs. Most of my patients are importantly to be used as beta blockers have a highly selective effect in reduction cardiovascular outcome events, including mortality, proven for the at least 3 years, and those also with or without normal LV function can be used indefinitely to reduce overall mortality and MI or sudden death. In conclusion, beta blockers are the cornerstone in the management of cardiovascular disease. They are indicated to reduce systolic systolic heart failure, HFrEF, post myocardial infarction and ischemic heart disease chronic. There are also controversies, however, in guidelines in the use of beta blockers as an initial treatment in hypertension. However, the beta blocker use is critical in protecting heart of young, obese, hypertensive, diabetic, and highly sympathetically overdriven or hyperactive patients. For that reason, I would say beta blockers is here to stay and is recommended as first-line treatment in most of our patients with hypertension and sympathetic overdrive. I will stop at this level and wait for your questions. I have received some questions here. I will start. What about using beta blocker during pregnancy? During pregnancy, there is a little bit of controversy about the use of beta blocker. In fact, there is no direct cardiovascular effect on outcome of the baby during pregnancy, during fetalhood, let's call it, induced by a beta blocker. The only concern is expressed by gynecologists who are specifying the need to monitor the heart rate of the baby, particularly when checked every now and then, and particularly before term, to, because the heart rate may be affected. And as you know, slowing of the heart rate of the baby may indicate that the baby is suffering. So it may confuse the gynecologist, obstetrician at the time, whether or not an urgent delivery should be conducted. So there is a concern, but if necessary and has to be given, particularly in patients with very highly sympathetically overdriven young women, I believe it can be used. I would try my best not to, and in a minority of my patients, I give them, and there are no concerns. The second question is, what is the emergency treatment of 210 over 110 blood pressure in primary health center before referring the patient to hospital? In any primary care center, a patient coming with a blood pressure of the kind, 210 over 110, I believe there should be at least one of the following. Nitroderm patch that can be given 10 milligram immediately. It may take about 10 to 15 to 20 minutes to start affecting. If not available, which I doubt, if it is not, it should be. Intravenous nitroglycerin can be used, and it has a modifying effect and usually prompt effect. We can also use intravenous beta blocker. Oral beta blocker may not be fast enough. So I would say metoprolol IV, which should be probably available in the emergency rooms, for example, can also be used. Subsequently, after the initiation of nitrate-based therapy or even intravenous beta blocker, we can start one of the following: hydralazine infusion, labetalol infusion, both of which have fast antihypertensive effects, and also in the higher, more sophisticated centers, nitroprusside infusion, which is the most effective of all what I mentioned, and usually should be given in those who have not only severe hypertensive crisis, but also pulmonary edema, especially if they are in heart failure. Nitroprusside infusion can be of great help. Now, another question: in diabetic patients with no evidence of nephropathy, which first-line therapy, ACE or ARB? Now, the usual education is that we start with an ACE, but many of us are, in practical terms, are avoiding ACE because they think that there is a higher rate of intolerance, although it is exaggerated. So I would say, whether you start with ACE or an ARB, the effect is more or less similar. The data on ACE inhibitor was stronger than that on beta blocker in general. I'm talking about ARB in general. The use of beta blocker without nephropathy, as is the case with ACE, it can be used. Of course, it can be added and can be used in alone if we consider that ACE inhibitor can cause more than 25% increase in serum creatinine, which is above a certain level, may not be acceptable. For example, if I have a serum creatinine of less than 150, I have no hesitance to use beta blocker or ACE inhibitor, or ARB to that term. So I would say I would use ACE or ARB. I may start with ARB and then ACE, or the reverse, depends on what the needs are. So low level to middle level nephropathy is not a contraindication to, let's talk it in different terms, stage one and two nephropathy is not a contraindication to ACE, neither that is to beta blocker. Beta blocker induce impotency in young age when they should be recommended in your young age. There is a big controversy about incompetence and the relationship to beta blocker. In fact, you have to know that incompetence is caused by hypertension per se, without even medicines. So it's one of the causes of impotencies in younger. However, there is a small group and a small minority of patients who might be affected with higher doses of beta blockers. So at low level, beta blockers, for example, bisoprolol 2.5 milligram, I have not seen an effect of the kind. And usually I could convince my patient that the problem is more likely to be from hypertension that is poorly controlled than it is with a low dose beta blocker. So if the question is, which first line, why should we recommend it in young age? Because young age is associated with sympathetic overdrive. So if this is a major contributor, especially in diastolic hypertensive young patients, this is mostly sympathetic overdrive, and it is very cost effective and reasonable treatment to consider a beta blocker. Now, let's talk about treatment of urgent hypertension. I think I alluded to it when it comes to severe crisis. In the absence, may I mention that in the absence of target organ disease, that is severe hypertension, but without pulmonary edema, without nephropathy, without severe left ventricular hypertrophy, we can start oral antihypertensives in the office. But we have to be careful that when we start the treatment, there is a recommendation to use single pill combination in order to achieve higher efficacy. Not only that, also we have to review monitor the patient carefully within few days in frequent visits in order to achieve satisfactory blood pressure control. Now, the question is, what is the best given for patient coming to polyclinic ER with hypertension? Again, severity have to be taken care of. If it is very severe, I mentioned earlier how to deal with very severe hypertension. With target organ disease, definitely should be intravenous management. Without target vessel, but we are having some sort of encephalopathy like mild confusion, no obvious CVA, but definitely an impending encephalopathic pattern, again, treat with intravenous parenteral treatments. Now, less than that, without target organ disease, or at least obvious target organ disease, you can start combination pills and or lower level of intravenous treatments and nitroderm patches that has a temporary but important transient effect, so that you can allow the oral treatment to take its chance to manage hypertension. Right side heart failure. In hypertension, you have to know that the hypertension causing severe, let's say severe left ventricular hypertrophy, severe diastolic dysfunction can cause pulmonary hypertension and can cause right heart failure. So is the association with hypertension, definitely treating hypertension will help improve right ventricular dysfunction or overload, in particular pressure overload, as long as we know that pulmonary hypertension is not related to underlying COPD, like severe chronic obstructive airway disease. That means it has to be left ventricular dysfunction, whether systolic or diastolic, contributing to the right side heart failure in the presence of hypertension, then treating hypertension in the manner that I mentioned. And in addition to diuretic, by the way, mentioning diuretics, I have noticed many of my patients coming from peripheral clinics are receiving intravenous Lasix for hypertensive crisis. It will reduce blood pressure, but I may tell you that nephropathy is one of the manifestations of hypertensive crisis. You may not, and you may see it in some patients, but if you see it, giving intravenous diuretic, particularly Lasix, may augment pre-renal failure or dehydration that can increase creatinine or BUN and may not be an advised approach. I would rather give vasodilators, including nitroderm patch, intravenous nitroglycerin infusion for a few hours while the oral medications are working, better than giving Lasix. Lasix effect will not last longer than a couple of hours. By the time the patient goes home, his blood pressure is high again and may end up visiting the clinic or the emergency room repeatedly before a definitive treatment is given. A question about nicardipine as a better treatment for hypertension. The studies on nicardipine were selectively done to those patients who have encephalopathies with associated severe hypertension. Unfortunately, it's not available, to my knowledge, whether it is present in the governmental institutions, I'm not sure. When I was in King Fahd Medical City, we have not used it. Neurologists have used it, but the experience is very limited. Is it a better treatment? It's a calcium channel blocker, as you know. Calcium channel blockers, particularly the nifedipine-based non-dihydropyridine therapies, which also nicardipine is one of them, has a strong and durable effect on controlling blood pressure, but I myself have no experience with nicardipine. Any effect of beta blockers on erectile dysfunction? If the term is any effect, yes, it can be, especially in the lesser selective beta blockers who are likely to affect the other non-beta 1 receptors. Yes, there may be, but I would reiterate that a lot of the importance manifestations are the same contributors to hypertension than it is to the treatment. What I mean, obesity, smoking, lack of exercise, psychosocial conditions, and even economic conditions all can contribute to the development of impotence. And separating all the what I mentioned from the effect of beta blocker will be difficult. In these situations, I will not hesitate to use low-dose beta blocker. And if, in particular, a patient who might complain from the beta blocker, I occasionally might withdraw it, but I have not seen it with low doses. What about captopril sublingual? Captopril sublingual reminds me of IV Lasix. It has a prompt, immediate, and also reminds me of rifampicin sublingual or Adalat sublingual, which is used to be available to us in the 90s and early 2000s. It used to be given in the ER. Again, the effect is severely and prompt lowering the blood pressure, but be careful. There has been cases of strokes caused by prompt reduction of blood pressure. The captopril effect, and actually I noticed some people are giving it sublingually even. They crush it and give it sublingual. It's strong, short, has no durable effect, and I'm worried about prompt reductions of blood pressure. That is why I do not recommend it. So neither sublingual nor oral, more or less similar to the other drugs that were used in the ER, and I do not support it. My support goes for, in addition to the oral treatment that I may start in the ER or in the clinic, polyclinic, I start my usual oral antihypertensive combination therapy is reasonably good to start with. Beta blocker is definitely additional to the treatment. I would, at the same time, if the blood pressure is severely elevated, use either nitrodem patch, and if not effective, intravenous nitroglycerin. It has a strong, good, slightly more durable effect, not very strong to prevent me from using it. Usually I start with low dose, I increase it incrementally, gradually, and you will see a reasonably fast result without complications. Withdrawal of nitroglycerin within the next few hours, at that time, the oral treatments would have made some effect, and then you can refer your patient to another institution. These are the number of questions that I receive. If you have additional, let me know. I hope I satisfied you with the answers and looking forward to hear more.